Hello, my beautiful Selma readers. I'm doing a video. I just arrived here at Dropout on Orcas Island and started sobbing. It is so beautiful and just like literally a babbling stream behind the house. And I'm going to take you on a quick tour. I started sobbing because I've been here before. So I met the founder of Dropout, Jennifer Brennick, by coincidence, here in 2009, or by fate. And when you see how beautiful this is, you'll really, really get it. Look at that. Nice. It just gets better and better. It's 25 acres. No internet service. Look at this. It is absolutely, oh, you can't even tell. Let me get you closer. You can see, I really, really love trees. I get a lot of strength and grounding from trees. And I just feel such a connection here. And something inexplicable drew me here in 2009. And I'm just so excited. I basically, when I went and I went to the back, I was like, oh, I'm gonna write my behind off. I really am. So I'm just gonna take you on a little, just hear the noises. And here's where I'm gonna set my full moon intentions, the Aries full moon. I'm an Aries. It's a great time to just, yeah, look at that. Anyway, I'm feeling deep, deep gratitude for Jennifer for inviting me here and for being part of the first group of writers to come to this amazing place and to be ready for my cells to come down, slow down, and just write. So, yeah, that's it. Thanks for visiting with me in my first, literally first 5 minutes being here. Bye. First evening at Dropout Orcas, and it's a full moon, new moon in Aries. And I decided that I would bring my crystal grid. I'm just learning about crystals. Crystals are the foundation of cell phone technology, computers. They are actually much older than us, and I'm just learning about them from people like Sherry Hayter, H-A-Y-T-E-R, Sherry with an I. She has taught me some really great basic things, which above all, your intuition trumps what people tell you. So I like that because I go with making stuff up a lot. So I thought I'd take a moment to show you on this special night. It's the way I put together this grid. There you go. There you can see it. And you can hear the water in the background and the frogs. And basically, I thought that I would take a lot of my favorite stones that are just my favorites because they're my favorites. And some of my other favorite things from St. Christopher Medal for protecting travelers, to this mermaid Lego that I really love that belongs to my son that I borrowed and then I gave back to him and then he said I could have it, which was kind of a big deal, to this special coin that's from England that I've used throughout my writing for the last 10 years. It's part of a ritual in the morning. And I've used it on and off, so I'm not saying that it was always consistent, but these are things that just have grown to be special to me. And basically, when you put together some sort of, you know, this is any kind of ritual that you want to make, it's really powerful if you just trust your gut. So I'm Catholic by, you know, how I was raised, and I really treasure a lot of the rituals that we have. And I've studied Buddhism, and I love pulling in from all different traditions. So
you know, I started mine with a sign of the cross, and I, you know, prayed to my grandmother, I prayed to my husband's grandmother, and called in all kinds of spirits and guides to just say, please give me courage during this time, because I want the freedom to really, really enjoy my time here and miss my family, because I really, really miss them. Even on the first night, I miss my husband and my son so much. And yet I love being alone, because it's been a really intense period of time, in particular over the last year. So I can feel my cells resting and realigning, and it's okay to feel that way. And I guess for anyone that's thinking of taking some time out, if the opportunity presents itself, I highly recommend it. I want the courage to be brave, even when I'm afraid to write. And just write. Right now, I just feel like being a recluse. I've been to this island before, and there's so much to see and so much to do. And I love kayaking and hiking and all these things. But you know what? I have beautiful 25 acres right here. I have great food, and I bought it at the grocery store. And I just want to write. And that is an incredible feeling, to have that spaciousness. So, you know, it just makes me want to cry. I'm so grateful. So I just thought you might want a glimpse of some of the everyday magic that I create for myself and that I learn from others, and adjust it to what works for me. Hope that this was fun for you, and I'll try to continue to keep you posted throughout my stay here. Bye. Hey, it's day two. I'm starting my day with my tea. Those of you who know me, I travel with tea everywhere. And this breathtaking view. Some of the things I'm thinking about today are, I want to know more about Hildegard's backstory and X's backstory. I think there's some interesting things potentially planned for them in book two, and it's fun to dive deeper into some characters who haven't gotten the play that, you know, in the first book. So, wishing you a really fantastic day whenever you see this. And, wow, here we go. Hey there, I was just sitting here listening and thinking about what I said to you about wanting to know more about Hildegard. And as I was just listening to nature, watching the ducks do some things, and then I just, boom, I got Hildegard as a little girl sitting in her great-grandmother Gigi's backyard. Her real name was Heloise, but she went by for great-grandmother G, the initials. And I have Hildegard living on Tola Island, so we're going to take a walk later with Hildegard as a little girl. But, of course, I was going to have another cup of tea, because I can be as caffeinated as I want and then crash and take a nap, whatever. So one of the things Gigi had just taught Hildegard was how to read tea leaves. Because you may recall from the first book, Hildegard prays over her tea leaves, and Gigi teaches her in secret, because we'll learn more about this, but Hildegard's mom did not, was not down with that. So I made a giant mess with my cup of tea and dumped tea leaves. Then I had to strain them again, but I thought you'd get a kick out of this, because there's tea leaves in the bottom of this cup. So what I'm going to do is keep writing and developing the character, and then read the leaves. And a lot, it's funny, I was going to bring, I have a book I want to study about Ogham. It's a study of trees. It's this Celtic approach. And the book I ended up, after much research, getting from the King County Library System, by the way, a used book from Washington State, it turns out. As the woman who wrote it was from or worked or lived in Washington State, is that she ended up developing a system that was all based on intuition and really built off of, she's a poet as well, built off of the traditional way of looking at it. And the reason I'm sharing this is because, quite simply, reading the tea leaves is just something I don't ever want to minimize what people have passed down through the generations. However, I can say things that are passed down through the generations are adjusted. So finding magic and creation and imagination in whatever you do and setting intentions. I was just thinking about the intentions I set for courage last night in the Aries moon, and I just want to thank you, because just the fact that you haven't even seen this yet, but knowing that people are out there reading my work gives me courage to do more. Because, you know, I just watched a video by Paolo Coelho, a live one from Facebook. It was wicked cool, and I only caught the tail end of it. But he said, there's my thumb, no matter of promotion can replace, you know, readers. Readers sharing how much they enjoy books. And, you know, the other thing he said, we don't write to please people, we write as an expression of our soul. And that's what I do when I write. So I appreciate that you enjoy reading that expression. And just thank you. Thank you for being on this ride with me. Until later. Hey friends, just a quick video on day two to show you the place where Selma sees her parents. It's pretty amazing to be back here. I haven't been here since 2009. This is Doe Bay on Orcas Island. And if you look, our cabin's just on the hill. I may take a snap of it when we go by. But I wanted to show you down here at the rocks. That's where she sees her parents, and she's sitting in a chair just like this one, waiting for the sun to come up, being magical and mystical. And up here is the Doe Bay General Store. And it happens to be Doe Bay Fest, the eighth one, which is my lucky number. So they're going to have music and lots of things here. And I just love the magic of me ending up here at that moment. So sending you lots of love, and thanks for being on this journey with me. Bye. Hello, day three. This is my second fire I built. I haven't ever done this before. And so I read very good instructions, except one word was the damper is something. And I don't even know what a damper is, and I couldn't Google it because there's no internet. So a couple things I've learned. When you open down here, this was an instruction, it lets more oxygen in to really, really fuel the fire. Now watch how the fire changes. You see it burning brighter? Well, there's a lot to learn from fire. And this morning, as I face a big, open, spacious, free day to write with no pressure, right? So nobody's checking how much I write. To walk in nature, to just be. As I sit with that, I really had to work through some of my own feelings of fear, hurt, anger. And so what I did
as I built this fire, I decided to take some of the grocery bags. Usually you stoke, you know, with newspaper. Do you see it? What a huge difference. And I wrote down all the things I wanted to release myself from. Old things that I really worked on. But I noticed with awareness that when I'm faced with a completely seemingly unrelated situation and I find myself having a more intense reaction, it's almost like my reaction has been given too much air and oxygen because it's something stuck inside of me. So what I was able to do was write them down one by one, crumple them into a ball, and burn them in this fire. Then I'm gonna close this. Now look at the fire. It's still gonna heat the house. That's what I learned, is the fire doesn't have to look like that big, giant explosion. It can just be slow, tended embers. And I think that is a really powerful lesson in how to really release on up here. And I don't know if you can see, you probably can't now, there's a bit of the smoke, the wood smoke coming out, but it was really coming out when the fire was high. So I leave you with that. And just want to really, really encourage you that when you can, whether it's in your car, in a quiet place, in the woods, somewhere where you can release, yell, scream, do what you need to do to not have to carry around weights, the weights that keep you from pursuing your dreams and even just living your daily life in a way that is lighter and filled with joy and warm. So your fire is stoked, but it's not fueled by that fierce oxygen of constantly feeling that old stuff that fuels all the other things that get complicated for no reason. So they may not even be outwardly complicated because you're so high functioning. So that's my words of wisdom from day three. I have no idea what I'm going to work on today in terms of characters, but I know I need a hike in nature to kind of ground myself even further after all of this release and continue my own personal healing so that I can, as I said in an earlier piece, express my soul through writing, and that soul can be filled with light that I share with you. Thank you. Good evening on day three. Ooh, there's a little noise back here. I'm curious. Wanted to show you this little island within the pond that I walked the wrong way around and got really muddy, which was fun. And now my shoes are drying by the fire, the big blazing fire that I actually, it's that embers I talked about earlier today. I've been quite successful with it. So I just wrote, it's interesting, I wrote, I've been writing this backstory to Hildegard, Hurley's mom, when she was a little girl, about her relationship with her great-grandmother, Gigi. I wanted to take you across this bridge with me because, as you can see, I got pretty wet the first time, but let's see how I do this time, and hopefully, hold on, I gotta pull my thermos in my hand because that would be a bummer if that fell down. Okay, ready? Okay, here we go. And I'll tell you about the story. You go right through the middle kind of fast. Yeah, I didn't get wet. So, I have been writing a lot and found a connection between Hildegard growing up for a good part of her childhood on this island that I invented called Tola Island, that's off the coast of South Carolina. And I wrote a series of short stories that are on my blog related to her best friend, Caro.
named after the corn syrup. And I'm commingling some things right now that are really, really exciting to me because I always like that story. Excuse me. And then the thing I'm interested in now, and I think I'm actually going to, I need to walk a little more. I took a big walk around the lake today, but I think I'm going to walk a little, and I'm working on, I'm developing a lot of these characters that you saw a little bit in the first book because they're going to have larger roles, and I need to kind of figure out their backstories. And so you may remember Claire's grandmother gave her a ring. So I already wrote a scene during National Novel Writing Month about that ring. But I want to explore their relationship a little more, and I need to walk to kind of loosen things up again. Do you hear the frogs? There were these big cawing, like yelling at each other birds, and they looked like giant herons. Never heard them make sounds like that when I was laying in the hammock. So anyway, hopefully I'll come up with something spectacular. But this is what the process is like for me. A lot of other people are more linear and they have an outline and figure it all out ahead of time. And it just never works that way for me. So anyway, I hope you are enjoying this film that I'm going to edit together, and more to come. Bye. Hey, you can't even see me, but do you see that moon? And do you see the reflection of the moon right there? I wanted to share this moment. It's almost 9 o'clock. There's people camping here at the lake, and I was called here to write the scene right at dusk of, you can't see me, so I'll just give you a quick view of the lake because it's really breathtaking. A quick scene of, you can't really see anything. A quick scene of Claire and her grandmother and the in-between. And it was a memory of Claire's grandmother in Ireland, which I'll just, spoiler alert, included some fairies. Anyway, I'm just getting so much out of this dropout writer's residency. It's really a retreat. It's been transformational for me. So thanks for witnessing and bonne nuit. Hey guys, I'm just back from the lake. There's no ambient light, so it's just amazing. Anyway, my fire's still burning, so I'm really excited because the sneakers that I got soaked when I crossed that bridge earlier are drying, I hope, by tomorrow. Alright, well, tomorrow's day 4. I wonder who I'm going to write about tomorrow. I'm feeling really energized after today and healing in the morning, and maybe a nice walk in the morning too. All right. Sweet dreams. Good morning on day 4. I find that I'm taking advantage of every part of the house. Today I'm on the back deck and snuggled in this blanket. Just had some tea and cereal, listening to this amazing sound. I'm going to do a video of just that sound to remind me of this experience. This has been life-changing. The ability to be unscheduled and be in nature and be unplugged. It's been hard sometimes, but I've had some transformative personal healing, great writing, really good story development. I feel great about what I've produced. And part of that is really taking the time to listen and breathe in my surroundings and imagine. And I think for those of us who work full-time jobs and have busy lives, and even if you don't work a full-time job, just things get busy, it's hard to find that space. So what I'm hoping to take home is the ability to carve out these moments, because in actuality, the writing itself doesn't take that long because it comes in a whoosh, like that. Part of the luxury is that when it comes, it's like I can just do it. I can do it. I can pull over to the side of the road, or like this morning I woke up at, I think it was 6 something, and yesterday I woke up at the same early hour as if I was going to work, and I couldn't go back to sleep yesterday. So today I woke up and I thought, I've been thinking about X a lot because he's a complex character. I have a lot of compassion for him. You will too. I'm sure you saw some foreshadowing from the last, just his backstory. So I woke up and at this line, "I can't stand the smell of raw meat," came up. You know, it's everywhere. It's even in my bedroom. We live above my dad's carniceria, and the only place I can get away from it is at school. Right? And I can't read you more because it's totally going to be a spoiler. But I'm getting insight into him. See, these are things like, they're not predetermined. They just come. So that's the beauty of writing. That's the beauty of listening. And I think that it's a lesson for me and for all of us that are interested, not just in writing, but in really listening to your intuition and your inner voice. For some people, that's God's voice. For some people, that's source. For some people, it's a mix. For me, you know, I asked my grandmother to keep me company. And you know what? And for courage. And my husband's grandmother passed this year, and I've been calling on her lately. And, you know, it's important, I think, when you believe whatever you believe, to allow yourself space to call in whatever can help you be most true to yourself, whether it's deciding what you're going to eat and when and how you're going to eat it, like sitting down and really enjoying your food versus standing up at the counter rushing and not even nourishing yourself. And that is something that I continue to learn myself. Or it's whether to apply for a job or whether to write that book. And I will tell you right now, write that book, write that story, write that poem, write that letter. Try whatever it is you want to do, try. So with that, I think I'm actually going to go into town for a little bit. My reading is tonight. I'm really excited about it. And I wrote a new poem here. I'm going to read my Mama Cello poem in her honor. And then I'm picking the parts from Selma. So I'm debating whether to read the part in Do Bay here on Orcas Island or another part. So anyway, thank you, readers. Bye. Hey there, I'm ready for my reading. I am really, really excited. It's Sunday, we're going to Mia's in East Sound. And just wanted to share with you, I'm reading from the novel, but I'm gonna open up with my Mama Cello poem, which you can find on my blog, RebeccaInspiresNow.com. And then I'm gonna read, I decided to read the scene in Uganda. In case you haven't read the book, it's a very climatic scene in Uganda. A short part of it, and then I'm also going to read a little bit. This is an adult writer's audience, so I'm going to read a little bit about the guardian Gwadi, Selma's guardian, and her former love, Soleimani. I'm going to read a little of that, which also mentions Orcas Island. And then, time permitting, I may read more of the novel, but I've got a couple of poems I really, really like. One I wrote here at 11:30 at night in all of my collage cafe journals.
And then if I have time, I'm also going to read another poem that I wrote here that I read out loud on my Facebook page. I don't know if we're Facebook friends, then you've seen it. And then time permitting, I don't think there'll be time permitting, but if I feel called to, I might read some new scenes that I've written, particularly about Hildegard, her great grandmother, her great grandmother goes by GG, the initials GG. I just did my reading poetry. For Dropout. Woo! Poetry! Yeah! And it rocked and it was life-changing. And this is Jennifer Brennick, JB. The founder.
This is JG.
And this is Maggie. Who's the assistant director of Dropout. And I just want to say that whatever you do, find out about Dropout, because this is a life-changing, transformative experience. And seeing and listening to the work of the writers on this island has been magical. So rock it. Hey there, it's my last full day to write, and I feel so excited and so grateful. You can see that pier. I've spent a lot of time on that pier. I wrote a pretty significant, kind of had some insight about how some of the elders in the book are going to gather in book two. There's some really lovely things corresponding with the power of those elders and each of the main characters that are going to feature prominently. And I can tell you now, right now it's Selma, Hurley, X, and Claire. So one of the things that I want to share with you, besides the fact that, as you know, yesterday's reading was amazing, I was thinking a little bit about process, and if you're interested in writing or anything, you know, you can translate this to other things you like to do. So I came here, I wanted to say goodbye to my son before he left for school. Didn't get enough sleep, but it was just up and happy and excited. So threw a bunch of stuff in a bag, thought I'd grab my backpack, don't have it, but have like 18 notebooks and pens and different size notebooks. So I just said, okay, listen, you're not supposed to walk with a backpack. So I am going to start walking on this trail that goes all the way around this lake. So you can see it all the way that way. It's going to go take me right back to where I'm standing, in theory. And I just have a little tiny notebook, my phone, you know, ID and water, and pens. And so sometimes I think all of us think before we start an exercise regimen, before we start meditating or make these resolutions, or, you know, it has to be perfect. You know, you have to have the right notebook, the right pen, the right sneakers, or even to start your life, you have to have the right partner or whatever, get over something. Every day is a new day to try again. So I'm going to try to remind myself of that too, because I miss circling with other writers in person and realize that I haven't even thought about doing that in my new home because I've been, you know, adjusting. It's been a huge period of transition and thinking about what that would look like to circle with some other poets, because last night just listening to the work of people on this island was so enlightening, motivating, fun, heartwarming, heart ouching, because there was some just beautiful, compassionate vulnerability, brokenheartedness, and just strength. And that's why we create. So anyway, sending you big love, hoping that this walk inspires some things. I think moving my body always inspires things, and I really hope I can get a good nap in later by the wood fire stove, which I now know how to light. Okay, till later. So this is an example. As I'm walking, I stumble upon this beautiful tiny secret passageway of water that's flowing across the trail and into Cascade Lake. So then I think about part of the, there's going to be a pseudo kind of quest. And again, I don't want to give too much away, but I think the first thing I thought of was find the secret waters. And that's something that our heroines and heroes and sheroes will have to do. And that alone is some of the ways that I help nature help shape my story. When you find the brightest green moss, then you'll know you're almost there. Really, they're coming. Read the roots. Tell us what to do. I can't. My mom didn't finish teaching me. She didn't have time. Oh my gosh. Well, X, you told us to do, go left. Where do we do? They're coming. I can see her pink shirt. Jump in here. Jump in here. Trust me. What? That's a barbecue pit. I'm not jumping in there. Trust me. Wait, I think we're at the place. I don't know why I know, but I think we're at the place. These four trees, it's one for each of us.
I know which one I am, X said.
Claire ran to the thin one that was greenest of greens and said, this is mine, I'm sure of it. Selma looked at Hurley. You pick. I have no idea, Hurley. Trees are your thing. I think you're next to X, and I'm next to Claire. Selma looked at Hurley, kind of sideways, and said, okay. So what do we do? Walk closely. And then I think we're supposed to each touch, ask permission of the tree, and then we're supposed to touch with both hands each of our trees. This is all connected, so I think this will give us something, some kind of power. I'm not sure which. And like I said, my mom didn't finish teaching me, but something tells me this is a stopping place. Okay. I reached over and touched my tree with both hands. It was like a light ran through me. Everybody is doing the same thing. Everybody does the same thing. They disappear. You guys, I can't see you. What happened?
I can't see you either. What?
No. We're all invisible? Hurley, what did you do? We made it. This is it. I know it. I know this is it. This is it. This is what? Said Selma. Says Selma. It's the fairy tree. A fairy tree? What are you talking about? Remember I told you about my grandmother Mavis? It's a fairy tree. Trust me. She was kissed by fairies. She's fairy kind. She told me to look for a tree someday close to the road in plain sight. That has all the roots exposed. And it has to be really, really tall.
So skinny, tall, it seems unassuming, right? In the midst of these other trees. But I know it. I can feel it. My ring is tingling. And, oh, see? Down there? Do you see it?
I see a hole with cobwebs. That's the awning. That's how we get into the fairy tree. X sputters. How do you expect me to get in there? How do you expect any of us to get in there?
I know I can use my ring. My grandmother's ring. Ever since I can't get it off. It's zinging now. It's zinging. I know I can use it. Well, what?
Wait a minute, Claire, says Hurley. What do you mean use it? It'll make us smaller. Trust me. Everything else has worked on this more or less trip, right? It's not exactly a trip. It's kind of an escape. Well, that's what we're doing. We're escaping. Trust me. I'll get us back to our normal size at some point or another. Guys, we really don't have another choice, says Selma. Okay, let's do it.
I thought I'd give you a little glimpse of my notebook. That's one of a couple I'm working from. I had my little tiny one when I was running in the woods earlier. And I'm very sleepy now. I woke up, I think I only slept about 6 hours because I was so wired last night. And then I woke up early and I was just raring to go. So came over here to the teepee. I don't really know that this is a teepee, but you can see how beautiful it is to be under here. And the pond is here, which is really lovely. And the hammock. And I'm about to go take a nap in the hammock. And then I may go to some hot springs and get ready to go tomorrow. I have a lot of writing done today. I also ate the best Lopez Island clams at Olga Cafe. Literally one of the best meals of my life. They're also famous for their cinnamon rolls, which were good. And I used the cinnamon roll as a device for writing about this evil character in book two. I'm struggling with her name a bit, but her description was inspired by an event on my hike. So it wasn't a big event, but I made it in my imagination. I did, and that's why I started running, which was really cool and fun. So I hope that I can come up with some more before I leave. And I have way a lot of time between when my ferry gets to the mainland and my flight. So I'm going to do one of three things. I got some suggestions from folks, so I'll keep you posted and maybe get some more writing done while I'm in transit tomorrow. So this to say, rest is important and the creativity keeps flowing. Thank you, nature. Thank you, Dropout. Bye. There, it's the last day of writing, and I'm really excited because I came over to the Doe Bay Resort, which is where I stayed in 2009, and this beach combined with a video I believe I did earlier where Selma was sitting in this Adirondack chair and her parents came up I combined them at the end of the book. So it was like she saw them down at the rocks, but from a landscape perspective in my mind, I used this beach as an inspiration for where some of the culminating conversation. Spoiler alert! If you haven't read it. But I don't think you could really, forget I would explain anything. But this is beautiful, beautiful falls right here. And I just, look at that. I mean, that right there, see that tree? And then the background, I mean, it's just, this is a magical place. I highly recommend coming to Dropout. Even if you're not a writer or creative, I believe you can get it at certain times of the year as a vacation rental. But creatives, painters, any kind of creatives, it's not just for writers. The other piece that I wanted to share with you that was a growth, I think, in terms of, you know, giving myself permission to write and adhere to a process that I would just completely make up during this. I don't know if I mentioned, I did the hot springs in the sauna, which is phenomenal offering here. They're natural hot springs. So I have these three journals I'm going to show you. I have more journals than this. I also have the tiny journal I ran around the woods with today. The top two and the tiny journal, which is in my pocket, are from Collage Cafe. And the bottom one is the Claire Fontaine French copybook. It's just a notebook. So the orange one is where I've been writing the bulk of the dialogue, stories. That beautiful little handmade one you saw on the front that says enjoy the journey, that is where during National Novel Writing Month, I just was trying to make some tentative steps, even if I couldn't adhere to actually writing every single day. Here's my other ones in my pocket. This is the one I ran around the woods with today when I forgot my backpack. And took lots of notes and then did videos too with scene dialogues and capturing certain places where things would occur. Even if they weren't in Washington State, the woods provided just what I needed for a really important chase scene. And so that little notebooks are really helpful just to have to jot down ideas. That special notebook, sometimes with special notebooks, like that handmade journal by Lindy Stockton of the Collage Cafe, a really bestie of mine. I don't wanna just like write just anything in there. So I used it to do character sketches during National Novel Writing Month, where I simply put the name of the character and what they like, who they love, and just some ideas, because selfishly I love researching certain things, some mystical, some food, some, you know. So that has been a reference for me while I've been here, and I did that back in November. The orange book is where, like I said, I'm writing the dialogue, and the one in the middle, that cardboard colored one, craft brown one, is quite simply my journal for when I'm here, because of all the little sort of dear diary part, like this is what I did today, but also the things I'm learning, the things I'm healing, and just tons of gratitude, just tons and tons of gratitude and awe and a humongous gratitude to my husband and my son for really supporting me in this, because I almost didn't do it. And my husband said, you have to do it. And I was thinking I wanted to, but it's like, I was hard to finish that. All these videos take up a lot of space. To finish that point is, I needed to give myself permission and have the courage to come. And, I'm just so grateful that my husband is, when I'm teetering on the edge of leaping, you know, and looking at these rocks, it makes me think of that. He's always there to cheer me on, and it's just, not to mention, or to mention, my tribe, my really close friends have just said, go, 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 and I'm forever changed by this experience. So I literally was going in those hot springs and just thinking, I'm the luckiest girl in the world, and I wish the same for you. I really do. I wish...
opportunities open up for you in life like this. And even Jennifer gave me the most beautiful introduction, JB, last night. And that was from our encounter in 2009. So you never know when you meet people what might occur, like this magic. Thanks. Hey guys, one last quick video before I leave Dropout. Biggest lesson, plug into nature. Plug into nature, plug into nature. Even if you're in a city, look at a tree, touch a tree, see grass. I know for many, including myself, it was an unusual idea, but I'll tell you right now, I am forever changed by this experience, and a huge part of it was being able to really be in nature this way. So I'm going to create the space for that, even in small increments, amidst the busyness of my job, amidst the busyness of family life. I'm going to integrate that more. So I'm wishing you the best. I'm off to the ferry. Bye. Hey guys, I'm on the way back over to the mainland from Orcas, and it's a windy, overcast day. Pretty much the perfect day to head back home. I'm really, really grateful to have had this experience. I always want to thank JB and Dropout. And I wanted to encourage you to consider coming to Orcas Island. It's a beautiful place. You just have to land in Seattle, drive 2 hours to Anacortes, and hop on this ferry. It's a beautiful, magical place, as you can see from the footage I've shared so far. And I want to assure you that whatever it is you wish for hard enough, and if you take the measured steps, take small measured steps every day or just something, even if it's not every day, once a week, to get what you want, whatever that is, you'll get it.